the last class we had seen how the chamber pressure and thrust varies with burning surface area and throat area and initial temperature. In this class let's look at how to design a grain. Okay, typically if you are in an industry, what is given to you is a thrust time curve. Okay, project managers will hand down to you a thrust time curve and you are supposed to meet it with whatever propellants that you have. Okay, please remember whenever we are talking about thrust time curve, if you remember the thrust equation, F is equal to right. Now rho p and isp are fixed depending on your choice of the propellant and nozzle, right. The only parameters that you can vary are ab and r dot. Let us say you are given a propellant with a particular r dot. How do you then design the grain to meet the thrust time requirement? Okay, the thrust time requirement can be varied depending on the applications. Okay, launch vehicle might have a thrust time curve something like this. Right, whereas a missile might have a very different thrust time curve. This might be the thrust time requirement for a launch vehicle, whereas this could be the thrust time requirement for a missile. Typically in a missile you would want to take off at very high acceleration so as to overcome any wind loads and other things, right. So you would have a very high boost thrust, after which you will come down and try to maintain the sustained portion for a long time so as to be able to reach the target. Okay, so how do we meet all these different requirements if we are given a propellant whose density and ISPs are fixed and r dot very little to play around with? Okay, the margin for playing around with r dot is smaller. So how do we design such a propellant? Now if you remember our earlier discussion, we said r dot is nothing but burn rate along the local normal. Right? We can now look at different kinds of geometries. Firstly, let us look at neutral burning grain, that is if you have a cigarette burning configuration, then as time progresses the burning surface will move in this fashion, right? Now, how does it look like if you have a tubular grain? If you have a tubular grain, and let us say it is burning from inside to outside, you will have concentric circles, right? The same if it is burning from outside to inside. This will give you a progressive grain. Now, as I said earlier, this R dot, you have a small amount of flexibility here, not a whole lot. Now, we have to get everything that we want or a lot of it through the burning surface area variation, right. So, if you have to design a large motor, large thrust motor, then if you cannot have an end burning grain, and if you are still desiring something like a neutral burning up to some portion and then progressive, how do we go about designing such grains? Okay. Remember, in our earlier discussion, we talked of something known as star grain or star geometry, and we said that it can give neutral, regressive or progressive depending on how you design the shape, right. So, let us look at how that is possible, right. Before we get into a star grain, we have to look at how the propellant burns. Let us say we take a burning surface like this. This is known as spike singularity, okay. Let us say it is burning along the local normal like this. How would it look like after some time? This would move parallel, right, and this would also move parallel. This point here would get extended into an arc of a circle. Let us say this distance is y, this would also be y, and this arc would also be of y radius, okay. So, a point here, this is a recess singularity, okay. So, a point here, the burning surface area is increasing, right. It was a point here, and the burning surface area is increasing depending on this arc length, right. The longer the time you burn it for, this arc length keeps on increasing. So, you want to get, if you have this kind of a singularity, a progressive burning, right. Now, let us look at how to get the regressive burning. If you have something like a spike singularity, okay, let's say it's burning in this direction, after some time what would happen? Sorry, if it were burning in this direction, after some time this surface moves in this parallel direction, this moves in this parallel direction. So you would be ending up with losing certain surface area, right? The surface area keeps on reducing, and over a period of time probably it will become horizontal, right? So this will lead to regressive burning. Okay. So if we can have a judicious mix of the progressive and regressive burning, or if we can have spike and recess singularities, then we have a chance of having a tubular grain, and then even then having something like a neutral burning. If you remember, if you have a tubular grain like this, you will always end up having progressive burning, right? But if you remember, we need a large surface area in order to get the required thrust. So, and we also are looking for something like neutral burning for a significant portion of the time. So having something combining spike and recess singularities will lead to what is known as neutral burning up to some time, and that is possible with a star grain. If you look at this picture here, on the right hand side you have the star grain, okay, and this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 point star grain, right. Now what kind of singularity is this? A is a recess singularity, okay, it is burning in this direction. So A is a recess singularity, and B is a spike singularity. So if you combine these two, you will hopefully get neutral burning, okay. So that is the idea of having a star grain. On the left hand side you have a picture here wherein you have a rectangular slot, okay, burning from inside to outside. If you look at all the corner points A, B, C, D, right, what kind of singularities are all of these? This is a recess singularity, because if you look at after some time the surface area is increasing, okay, and if it progresses like this in this direction, in this direction, there will come a stage wherein you will have some propellant unburnt, okay. That portion of the propellant that is unburnt is called as sliver loss, okay. At the time of burnout, he is known as sliver loss. So if you look at the propellant that we had, so towards the end if right this corner point reaches here much faster, and therefore you will have some portion of it remaining unburnt. This is known as sliver loss, and as a designer you would want to minimize this. There is no point in carrying propellant on board and not utilizing it. It's a waste in that sense, right? So you would want to minimize sliver loss. And if you look at the reason for wanting to have a neutral burning, right? Why do we want to have a neutral burning? No, it's not related to sliver loss. Yes, if you look at the structural utilization, okay, let me first draw that figure. If you look at a thrust time curve, if you have, let us say, a regressive burning, okay, and if you have progressive burning, this is also the variation in some sense with the chamber pressure F and PC go in a similar fashion, okay. What pressure do you design your casing for? It is for the highest pressure, right? In this case you design it for this pressure, and in this case you design it for this pressure. Although you are designing the case for the highest pressure, you are utilizing it for a very small time, right? If you were able to in some sense utilize the entire burn time at that pressure, your thrust or the specific impulse would have been higher, right? You are not doing that, and you are trying to kind of utilize that highest pressure only for a small time. So from this perspective it is better to have a neutral grain as far as possible. This part is the ignition peak, we will come to that a little later in the course. So if this is the mean pressure at which it is operating, and if it is a constant, then you can design the motor based on this pressure with a certain factor of safety, and you will be utilizing it for a much larger time, and therefore you will have the benefit of a higher ISP, okay. That is the reason why we would want to have a neutral burning for as long as possible. Now let us look at star grain. If you look at the 6-point star grain that we have here, you see that if you consider this segment, right, this small segment here, because of symmetry, if you consider not just that small segment, if you consider the segment here, if you draw a line from A to the center and along B, if this is the origin AOB, that segment is good enough because that is the segment that is repeating. Because of symmetry, it is good enough if you consider only that segment. Okay. Now that is the segment that is shown here in this figure. If you look at it, this is going from zero or origin O, A and B. Let this length 0 to A B L. Okay. Now, what kind of a singularity is this point B? Spike. And A is a recess singularity. So there is with burning. Let us say it is burnt up to some web thickness of y. Okay. If it has burnt some web thickness of y, the position of A will be shifted to A dash. A dash to C is the arc that you are getting as an increase in the burning surface area, right. And there is a reduction in the burning surface area. If you look at A to B is the surface area, right? As this point B moves from B to B dash, the surface area is reduced from A to B to C B dash. Okay, so there is an increase in surface area. There is a decrease in surface area. If these two are equal, then we will get neutral burning. That is, burning surface area is not changing with. Okay. So let us try and derive the condition that will give us neutral burning. If you look at this figure from the previous figure, this is right, you have this is a 6-point star. Okay. Now the n here is 6. Fine. If you have a 6-point star, this angle would be 2 pi by n. No, this angle would be pi by n. Okay, because you are also considering the other portions. So this angle would be pi by n. And if you look at this angle here, dB dash. This angle is nothing but theta by 2. Okay. This will be given to you. So this angle is theta by 2 and this angle, you know. So you can calculate the other angle, that is ABO. ABO will be nothing but pi minus theta by 2. And so therefore we can calculate the angle OAB, right. We know the other angle AOB is pi by n. So we need to calculate OAB. We also know AOB is nothing but pi by n. Then we can calculate angle OAB. What will this be? The entire angle, the sum of all the angles in a triangle is pi. So you will have pi minus So this two cancel out, and you will get, sorry, this is plus this plus this, so you will get minus pi by n plus theta by 2 as the angle OAB. Okay. Now you know this angle. The other angle, that is BAC, is a right angle, right? So that is 90, and OAA dash is a straight line. So this angle is 180. So 180 minus 90 minus this angle will give you A dash AC. So we have determined this angle. This angle, this what we had noted earlier was AC is the increase in the burning surface area, and BD is the decrease in the burning surface. Now we have taken a two-dimensional grain, and we need to look at this in depth. Okay, into the plane is the depth, right? So this is a two-dimensional grain, so that remains constant. So we are essentially calculating a burning perimeter, right? So for neutral burning, A dash C should be equal to okay. Now we have determined the angle A dash AC, so the length of the arc AC would be y into the angle itself. A dash C is nothing but y into the angle, that is pi by 2 plus now we have to determine DB. So if you look at the triangle B dash D B, right, the D to B dash is nothing but Y. This length we know, this angle is 90 degrees, that is B dash DB is 90 degrees, and we know that DB B dash is nothing but this angle is theta by 2, and we want to find out what is this distance DB. Okay, this is nothing but y cot theta by 2, right. DB is nothing but so if you look at the condition for neutrality, then AC dash should be equal to DB. DB we have found out, AC dash we have found out. Let us equate the two. So y cot theta by 2 must be equal to y into pi by 2 plus pi by n minus theta by 2. These two must be equal. So you will get the condition for neutrality as pi by 2 this must be equal to 0, right. Now as a designer you have the choice of choosing this n, okay. If you choose a particular n, there is a corresponding theta that will give you neutral burning, right. For a particular value of n, there is a particular value of theta that will give you neutral burning, and you can get that value of theta using this equation. Let us call theta n as the angle that gives neutral burning. Then if you have an angle theta greater than theta n, it will be regressive burning. And theta less than theta n, it will be progressive burning. If you look at this figure here, you will see that beyond this point, as far as it is going up to this point B double dash, there is a decrease in burning surface area that is possible, right. After this point, this entire curve A dash B dash moves parallel, and therefore it will only be progressive burning after that, okay. So up to the point B dash B double dash you can have neutral burning, beyond which it is not possible to have any neutral burning, and the grain will become a progressive burning grain, okay. And this portion here is what is known as the sliver loss, okay. So you can solve this equation and get various values of theta n for different point star grain, which is tabulated here. If you have n theta n for a 5-point star grain, 62.2 will give you neutral burning. So you get various angles increasing from 5 it is 62 to 12 it will be 85. Okay. Now we have talked about how it can be progressive up to point B double dash. Here in this figure I said it can be neutral, progressive or regressive. After that it will only be progressive, right. In this figure here what I have plotted is burning perimeter versus y by l, burning perimeter by l, and on the x axis it is y by l. So this is a non dimensional plot. Irrespective of what size of the grain you have, you can use this plot. So if you see here the point B double dash prime that I was talking about in the previous slide, okay, corresponds to this web burning of around 0.6. Up to this you can have regressive, neutral and progressive, beyond which it will only be progressive. This dashed line that you have here corresponds to a cylindrical grain. If you had a cylindrical grain you would have had it being progressive all through, but if you have a star grain with a n of 6, then you can have neutral burning up to some point and after which you can have a progressive burning. Okay. Now this tells us that if you, depending on the y by l, you can have up to a certain portion only neutral burning, right. And what we also need to keep in mind is what is the sliver loss that accompanies it. Okay. If you look at the previous figure here, you would be tempted to say if I have a grain stopping somewhere here, if I have burning only up to y by l of around 0.8, it will be very advantageous because you have neutral burning for most of the portion. But the other factor is if you stop it at a y by l of around 0.8, you see here the sliver loss. Sliver loss is slightly higher, and if you burn it further the sliver loss tends to reduce. On the axis here you have sliver loss by L square, here you have port area by L square, and the x axis is again y by L. This is again for a 6 point star. If you see the port area is increasing as you go from 0 to a y by L of 0.6, but the sliver loss fraction is reducing. So if you stop it early then you will have a higher sliver loss, which is again not an advantageous thing. You want to minimize this sliver loss. Okay. So as such in a sense the design is constrained. You want to get the thrust time curve that you want, you also want to have neutral burning for as far as possible because then your structural utilization will be better, and you need sliver loss to be as minimal as possible. All this in a sense are conflicting at some point. Okay. So and you need to find out for each particular grain which is the best possible design, right. Now what we had discussed here is something like two dimensional geometry, right. We said that the along the length the same geometries repeat, right. We had taken a cross section and we said along the length the same cross section repeats itself. So this is something like a two dimensional grain. We could get all the parameters that we wanted, namely how long will it burn neutral, how long will it be progressive, all that by doing a simple analysis. But if it were a three dimensional geometry as shown here, this is a finacoil, this is a conacoil, okay. these are three-dimensional geometries. That is, as you go from the nozzle end to the head end, the same geometry is not repeating itself. This is a slightly difficult, I mean, it is not easy to do this based on simple analysis that we have done. You need some computational strategies to find out how the burning surface area is evolving with time. Okay. Then you will be able to calculate how whether you can have neutral burning up to some length or not, right. And people have done this before. So, for a particular configuration, you can look at how long you can have neutral burning. In the case we had considered, neutral burning was possible up to 60% of the web thickness for a 6-point star grain, right. Now, let us look at other possible grain configurations and how long you can have neutral burning. If you have an end burning grain, what would be the extent? It is 100%, right. So, you can have 100% of the web as neutral burning. Then if you have a star grain, depending on the number of star points that you have, it can vary from 30% to 60%. And if you have conocoil that we just saw, it can range from 50% to 90%. And phenicoil, these are two-dimensional geometries. This is in fact a one-dimensional geometry, these are two-dimensional, and these two are three-dimensional geometries. So, if you go for a three-dimensional geometry, you could have a slightly larger compared to a two-dimensional one, but the end burning is the best. That is, you can have 100% of the web as neutral burning. What it will do if you can design such a grain is, not only are you going to utilize your structure very effectively, right, but you are also going to operate it at a same pressure for the entire burn time. So, your ISPs will be optimal also, and in addition you can load a lot more propellant, right. The propellant loading will increase. If you have any other kind of geometry, namely port burning configuration, there will be a certain fraction of the port that will be empty. So, your propellant loading will be lower, and therefore, you will lose out on in some sense the structural factor, right. That is, what is the fraction of the structural weight that is required to hold certain amount of propellant. If that is as small as possible, then your what the payload you want to carry will keep on increasing, right. So, it would be nice to have an end burning grain from all these considerations, but if you look at the burn rate requirement for these, the burn rate requirement will be phenomenal. If you work it out, it will be very large. So, therefore, in a sense we are not able to get those kind of burn rates, and which is forcing us to go towards a port burning configuration. And that then we are looking at all these kind of geometries to give us neutral burning up to a certain extent of burn web or a certain extent of web fraction. Okay. In this class we looked at how to look at what is happening when the propellant is burning in a steady fashion. If you notice, while the propellant has to be switched on, and also when this propellant has to be at the end of burning, there is a non-steady burning. That is, if you look at the thrust time curve, we have considered how it operates in this zone. We still need to find out what happens in these two portions. Okay, we'll do that in the subsequent class. And there was a question that was posed some time back, wherein you had asked me what happens as the propellant burns. There is more free volume, right? So shouldn't the pressure drop, and how do we account for it, right? Because the free volume is increasing, and therefore the concern was the pressure would drop, and how do we account for it. We'll also discuss that in the subsequent class. Okay, thank you.